and welcome to 10th Presbyterian Church this morning. As we prepare for worship, let us hear an encouragement from the book of Psalms. Praise the Lord. Praise, O servants of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord from this time forth and forever.
To see what the end will be. Well, hello, good morning, and welcome to worship today. If you're new to 10th, a particularly warm welcome to you. We're going to take our bulletins in a moment and use them to sing and to pray together. But before we do that, let's hear the word of God from Colossians chapter 1 concerning the Son, the beloved Son. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. Confess our sins together using the words you'll find in the bulletin. Let's all pray. Almighty God, to know you is the fulfillment of our deepest longings, the satisfaction of our most ardent desires. If we have sought our pleasures elsewhere and have put the seeking of idols above seeking you, we have failed to love you with all our heart, soul, and mind. And we have failed to love our neighbor as ourselves. Forgive us our sin, and grant that from now on we might serve you in newness of life. Hear these words of assurance, again from Colossians chapter 1, giving thanks to the Father, who has delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, even the forgiveness of our sins. Let your merciful ears, O Lord, be open to the prayers of your humble servants, that they may obtain their petitions. Make them to ask such things as please you, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forevermore. Amen.
seated. Today's responsive reading, Psalm 22, verses 1 through 18, can be found on page 457 in the Bible in your pew. After the responsive reading, please stand for the Gloria Patri and the Apostles' Creed. As we read, I will read the odd verses and we will all together read the even verses. Psalm 22. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me from the words of my groaning? O my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, but I find no rest. Yet you are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel. In you our fathers trusted. They trusted, and you delivered them. To you they cried and were rescued. In you they trusted and were not put to shame. But I am a worm and not a man, scorned by mankind and despised by the people. All who seek me mock me. They make mouths at me. They wag their heads. He trusts in the Lord. Let him deliver him. Let him rescue him, for he delights in him. Yet you are he who took me from the womb. You made me trust you at my mother's breasts. On you was I cast from my birth, and from my mother's womb you have been my God. Be not far from me, for trouble is near, and there is none to help. Many bulls encompass me. Strong bulls of Bashan surround me. They open wide their mouths at me, like a ravening and roaring lion. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It is melted within my breast. My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue sticks to my jaws. You lay me in the dust of death. For dogs encompass me. A company of evildoers encircles me. They have pierced my hands and feet. I can count all my bones. They stare and gloat over me. They divide my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. Please stand. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He ascended into heaven, and the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated.
Join me in prayer. Gracious God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we confess this morning that you do not change. You have not changed from eternity past, and you will not change forever. Yesterday, today, and forever, you are slow to anger, and you are abounding in steadfast love. You are forgiving our sins, and you are healing our brokenness. And yet we know you will by no means allow injustice to prevail on earth. And while we proclaim this truth that you are unchanging and that your love and holy justice will prevail, we confess, Lord, that we struggle to believe this. We confess that as we watch our world and we see the pain and sorrow, that it is difficult for us to continue to, by faith, believe that justice will prevail. We don't believe it when we look outside, and we do not often believe it when we look within. You have promised that you will forgive those who are in Christ, which we know is just because, as we just read in Psalm 22, you crushed your Son on our behalf. And yet when we look without and we see the world and we are pained and we are grieved and we weep, we by faith are striving to believe, Lord, that you will put all things to right, that Jesus' death will reconcile all things, and that all things will be bound up in him. And so while we struggle, we cry out, help our unbelief. We thank you that you have invited us to make this prayer. We thank you that the Psalms are full of rich honesty. David and others crying out of their brokenness and out of their sorrow. How long, O Lord, how long will injustice prevail? And we join their cry. And yet we do not weep as those who have no hope. We know our sorrow will not last. We know that the anxiety that plagued us this morning as we were on our way to church, we know that the stress that was overwhelming this past week at work, we know that the conflict that is between us at times and between us on the rest of our week, we know that that will not prevail. And we know it's because of you. And so we acknowledge that we rest only in that. That when we see things that we do not understand in our own hearts and in the world, God, we confess that we trust you. And we ask that as we do that, you would fulfill your promises, which we know are so rich. And they're all fulfilled in Christ. All of your promises are yes in Christ. And so it is to him, Jesus, our Savior, that we look to with great hope, the one who has ascended and is seated right now at your right hand, overseeing your church, this church, and bringing all things in the world into submission to your holy rule. And so, Father, we plead that until that happens, you would calm us and stir us to go out from this place with joy, trusting in you, going out from this place desiring to be salt and light in this city, going out from this place ready to forgive and ready to receive forgiveness. And this morning, stir us, Lord, to sing, to repent, to put our hope in our Savior Jesus. God, you are unchanging. You are unchanging, Lord. And so as we feel tossed to and fro, we ask that you would give us calm and that you would then stir us to be zealous, to worship you and to love our neighbor. Help us this day, we pray, towards that end, for Jesus' sake. Amen. Well, welcome again to 10th Church. Special good morning has already been extended to those of you who are new, but we know there are some new folks who perhaps just moved to town, and so we offer you an especially warm welcome. We're glad that you decided to worship with us this morning, or to check out what this church is about. And we hope that it would be an especially warm time for you. If you do not meet someone or if you have questions about anything going on here, I invite you to approach me at the back afterwards. I'll be standing back there. If you're new, I'd love to meet you and perhaps point you in a direction that might help you get connected here at 10th. We do have a few announcements as we continue in worship. The first would be that the young adult ministry will be meeting on the steps for our monthly out to lunch gathering. We'll gather out there on the steps around 12:45, and then we'll walk to an affordable restaurant and then get some food and meet back together in Rittenhouse Square. So do join us if you are a young adult here and would like to get some lunch. We'll meet on the steps at 12:45. Also, on Tuesday, August 22nd, from 9 to 11, we encourage you to join those who oversee the playgroup. They will be having a sudsy, soapy, fun time as they wash the much-loved toys that the children here in Center City get to enjoy each week. For those of you who don't know, the playgroup is an opportunity for young moms and dads to come and bring their children to play each week, and the toys need a bath. So come scrub the toys, 9 to 11 this Tuesday here at the church. Full details are in the bulletin regarding our upcoming soapy, sudsy fun. So we do have one other quick announcement that we received this morning regarding a change in plans for this evening. The WOW, which is our Wonders of Worship, will meet up in Fellowship Hall, not in the catacombs, for tonight's service. So if you know what Wonders of Worship is, you'll know what this announcement means. And instead of meeting in the catacombs, meet in Fellowship Hall for tonight's service. So those are all of our announcements for today. Once again, thanks for joining us for worship. We do hope that you're encouraged. And now I'd like to welcome up Steve Bachman for a report from our trustees.
Good morning. In Psalm 99, we read of Israel's ancient leaders, "Lord our God, you answered them." God has provided for us, giving himself in Jesus Christ for our salvation, his Holy Spirit for our empowering. Our Heavenly Father knows us and hears us. In our life together at 10th, we worship, serve, reach out, and are comforted together. That's how the body works. And we bear burdens together. As part of our shared ministry, your trustees report the following. As we work together for God's kingdom on earth, we have earthly expenses, including hard-earned compensation for pastors and others who literally are workers worthy of their hire. And we have costs like utility bills. But in ministry, most expenses are people costs. These costs are paid for as God provides for us all, and we give a portion of his provision to us in tithes and offerings, supporting ministries with our finances, as we also do with our resources of time and skills and our prayers. Today, we're talking about financial offerings. Year to date, those offerings simply don't match current expenses in the church ministry fund or outreach fund. And we're also behind budget in the important building improvement fund. The ministry and outreach gap to date is over $400,000 below budget. Projections, even seasonally adjusted for anticipated year-end increased giving, still project to around a $200,000 shortfall for the year between those two funds. That's cause for prayer and planning. We've taken steps to cut costs and find fresh efficiencies. Our staff should be commended for those ongoing efforts. Our senior staff has been asked to accept a 10% salary reduction starting next month. Their sacrifice, literally giving up part of their paychecks, leads the way for us financially in support of our ministry together, and they lead us in prayer. These guys pray. So should all of us, fervently. In faith, together, we secure space for future ministry through the Separate Capital campaign. At this moment, we also need our Heavenly Father to provide for our present ministry together. The projected gap is no small matter. I pray daily that God will provide, and I urge you to join all of us who pray for that. We also should pray for wisdom to handle ministry needs as we together face this financial crunch. Your trustees, David Fiore, Dave Collins, and I would be glad to speak with you about this. In stewardship, we want to finish 2017 without deficits. We'd love to restore senior staff's pay cuts and regain our footing for ministry going forward in the name of our great wonder-working Lord. This is His work we do together. Please pray to Him about this, including prayer about your own part in this time of stress. Frankly, please also think with your checkbook. But above all, pray. Pray to Him who is able to do immeasurably more than we ask or imagine, according to His power that is at work in us.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, as we gather here to worship you today, we are reminded of your unceasing goodness to us. Your mercies are new every morning. So it is with joy in our hearts that we bring to you these tithes and offerings, and we pray that you would bless them and multiply them and use them for the advancement of your glorious name here in Philadelphia and to the ends of the earth. It is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. Thank you.
this morning to Jonah chapter 3. That's on page 774 of the Church Bible. Jonah chapter 3. Let's hear the word of the Lord. Then the word of the Lord came to Jonah the second time, saying, "Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and call out against it the message that I tell you." So Jonah arose and went to Nineveh according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly great city, 3 days' journey in breadth. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's journey, and he called out, "Let yet 40 days, and Nineveh shall be overthrown." And the people of Nineveh believed God. They called for a fast and put on sackcloth, from the greatest of them to the least of them. The word reached the king of Nineveh, and he arose from his throne, removed his robe, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat in ashes. And he issued a proclamation and published through Nineveh, "By the decree of the king and his nobles, let neither man nor beast, herd nor flock, taste anything. Let them not feed or drink water, but let man and beast be covered with sackcloth, and let them call out mightily to God. Let everyone turn from his wicked way and from the violence that is in his hands. Who knows? God may turn and relent and turn from his fierce anger so that we may not perish." When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil way, God relented of the disaster that he had said he would do to them, and he did not do it. We saw last time as we came to this third chapter of the book of Jonah that the narrative is being driven by two questions. What is going to happen to Jonah? And what is going to happen to Nineveh? This third chapter records the surprising works of God as he begins to answer those questions. We saw last time that the word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. That was a surprise. That was completely unexpected and undeserved. Here is a man, a prophet of God, who has had a useful ministry as a prophet in Israel, and yet at the moment that God spoke to him the first time, chapter 1, verse 1, 2, he disobeys God, flat out disobeys God and goes in his own direction and without any hesitation goes as far away from where God wants him to be as possible. And there was a supernatural work done in Jonah's life. You remember he was thrown off the boat. That fish, famous fish, was there ready to catch him, and then to dive with him inside its belly, and then eventually throw him up on dry land. You all know the story. Whether we know what it means is another matter altogether. And now we're going to read the story of Nineveh. We're going to see that in Nineveh there's going to be this great revival, this great work of God in changing the hearts of the people of this city and rescue them. And both of these events, the story of Jonah and the story of Nineveh, are going to illustrate a principle that you find stated right at the very end of Jonah's prayer, which is recorded in chapter 2. The principle says this: salvation belongs to the Lord. The word salvation is a rescue word. Salvation, deliverance, rescue belongs to the Lord. Whether you're thinking of Jonah thrown overboard and drowning and rescued by means of that fish, whether you're thinking of Nineveh under the judgment of God and repenting and God relenting from sending the judgment, or whether you're thinking of yourself, you and I in this room today, and our relationship with God, when we put our trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, we are saved from death, hell, and are given eternal life. That's the reality of the work of salvation. And in all those kinds of saving, salvation belongs to the Lord. It is His work from beginning to end. So the word of the Lord then comes a second time to Jonah. And the word of the Lord is the same as the first time. As we learned last week, when God speaks to you and you don't like it, and He leaves you alone to the consequences of your actions or attitudes, and there comes a time when God comes and speaks to you again, don't expect that when He comes a second time that He's going to have to modify or has modified or changed in any way what He said to you the first time. God's word remains the same. He doesn't change in His word. And so the word of God comes a second time to Jonah, and he says the same thing. Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and call out against it the message that I tell you. Here is Jonah. He's being called to take the word of God seriously. He's being called to fulfill his ministry. He is to go to this city and he's to call out against it. He is to preach the message that God has put on his lips. And how do you preach a message like that? Well, Paul puts it like this: by setting forth the truth plainly. We commend ourselves to everyone's conscience in the sight of God. And that's what we see Jonah doing. He goes to Nineveh and he delivers the message. Here is the message. It's pithy, short, clear, punchy. The message is simply this: in 40 days, Nineveh will be overthrown. You have 40 days until you're nuked, is basically the message that God gave to Jonah to preach to Nineveh. Well, you say, isn't it wonderful that that's not the message that we have to say to Philadelphia or any of the other cities of this country? But in fact, I don't think that the message that Jonah delivers to Nineveh is very far removed from the message that we have to deliver to the inhabitants of this city or any other city in these United States or any other country of the world. Do you remember the Apostle Paul? He goes to Athens, that center of culture, that intellectual capital of the world. And what does he say to those people? God has appointed a day in which he will judge the world by that man whom he has appointed, Jesus Christ. God has appointed a day for judgment. Or you listen to Jesus himself as he's regularly telling the people of Judah and Jerusalem that there is a day of judgment coming, that God is going to judge the world. Or you think of Paul writing to the Thessalonians in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1. He talks about the righteous judgment of God. He talks about the day when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, inflicting vengeance on those who do not know God or in those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus. They will suffer the punishment of eternal destruction away from the presence of the Lord and the glory of his might. That's the message of the New Testament. It is the message of the Bible. And in a sense, we are not being honest with people. We are not being totally honest with our friends if we withhold that message from them. There is a day coming. It may not be 40 days from now, as the message was to Nineveh. It's actually more frightening because we do not know whether it's 40 seconds from now or 40 minutes from now or 40 months from now or 40 years from now. We don't know when it's going to be, but God has appointed a time in which he will judge the world by the Lord Jesus Christ, the very one whom we offer as the way of escape will be the means of judgment on that last day. And I want to say that I think this is a message. I wonder, As Jonah went to Nineveh, I wonder what he would have expected to happen as he went to deliver that message. I wonder if he would have expected mockery, that people would have been laughing at what he was saying. I wonder if he would have expected rejection from people as he spoke out his message. Or perhaps even worse than that, a bunch of thugs hired to get him in a corner somewhere and give him a beating, or perhaps even do him to death. And as we go out with the message of judgment, we go with the same fears or the same concerns. Those are very much the kinds of reaction that we have from people today. The reason that people object, of course, is A, they don't believe in God, and B, if they did believe in God, they believe in a God that accords to the wisdom of this world. He's a God who is actually not all that displeased with us. The world in its wisdom does not know God. And so we're told that Jonah went to this great city and he cried out. He cried out against it. You see, Nineveh was under the wrath of God. These people were not only outside of the chosen people. They weren't Jews. They were the sworn enemies of Israel. Assyria, Nineveh is the capital of Assyria. Assyria is the biggest threat to the national survival of God's people. You can see why Jonah perhaps hesitated to go and speak to them. Somebody has written about Nineveh this: in God's mind, Nineveh is not a quantity, but a quality. Not a mere metropolis, but an immorality. He takes the symbol of the ancient world's most impressive evil, magnifies it, and intensifies it by mass, and sends his prophet into the midst of it. Jonah goes into the city. He heads for the city center, and he proclaims a message of judgment. And there is a sense in which that is the message we have to proclaim to people today. Can you imagine going on primetime television, late night, one of these late night shows, and being asked what it is that the church has to say to America today? It's been appointed to men once to die and after that judgment. The Lord Jesus is going to be revealed with his flaming angels to judge the world. Well, you can imagine they'd have switched you off and gone to somebody else by the time you'd got all that out in a sentence. And that's the reality. That's what we find Jonah doing. What did he expect? He did not expect what happened. Suddenly, the unpredictable happens. Through the proclamation of Jonah, a light goes on in the heads of these people. What he has said will happen does not happen. Instead, there is this mass movement of repentance from the top to the bottom of society. Look at what it says. The people of Jonah believed God. That was incredible. They did the opposite of what Jonah had been telling them would happen. 40 days now, the judgment will fall. And in 40 days, the judgment did not fall. The prophet of God would be embarrassed. He'd be even more embarrassed as he saw the widespread take-up of this repentance. They called a fast. From the greatest of them to the least of them, the people believed God. The word reached the king of Nineveh, who got up out of his throne and removed his robes and covered himself with sackcloth and sat in ashes. From the highest to the lowest, from the greatest in the land to the deplorables, he got them all of them brought to repentance. It isn't just the simple, uneducated, I was going to say Baptist, but that would have been bad, so I'm not going to say that. But you know, it isn't the simplest and most uneducated member of society that needs to hear that there is judgment to come, that there is a hell to be feared. It is from the least to the greatest that need to hear this message. There is no one in this room so intellectually exalted that you don't need to hear that there is a judgment coming. It is for everyone, this message. And what happens? These people believed God. They heard Jonah, but they believed God. They saw beyond the man, and they heard the word of God, and they believed God. They believed what he said was going to happen, would happen. And a miracle is taking place. The hand of God can be seen in the faith of these people, in the belief of these people. Faith is a gift of God, the Bible says. Faith is the product in the human heart of the supernatural, unseen work of the Holy Spirit, creating faith in people's hearts. And so God, the Holy Spirit, works alongside God's holy word through his servant in this very powerful way, through these secret operations in the hearts of men and women. And they believed God. Faith often works energetically in our hearts. And it works usually according to the matter in which we believe. So these people believed there was judgment coming. So they reacted. They believed in fear to begin with. They believed in fear. They were afraid of what was going to happen. And that's all right as a first step. Fear is something that prompts us to take action. But not only did they respond in fear, but their faith responded in hope. Look at verse 9. Who knows, they asked, who knows, God may turn and relent and turn from his fierce anger so that we may not perish. There was a kindling of hope in their heart. Now, where did that come from? That did not come naturally. It wasn't some natural eruption of a latent hopefulness or a latent trust in God that emerged without the work of the Holy Spirit producing it. Because, as the Bible tells us, again and again, the apostle writes, the God of this age blinds the minds of those who do not believe. So this is a work of God, creating not only a fear of judgment, but a hope of mercy. Now, where did they get that hope of mercy? In Matthew, the Lord Jesus is confronted by the scribes and the Pharisees who come to him and say, teacher, we would like you to do some sign. We'd like a sign from you to help us believe what you're saying. I mean, we're the religious elite. We're the professionally religious people here. And we're not going to be taken in with all the stuff that these ordinary folks are being taken in with. So we would like a sign that would convince us. Jesus replies, an evil and adulterous generation seeks for a sign. But no sign will be given to it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. For just as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the great fish, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. The men of Nineveh will rise up on the judgment with this generation and condemn it. For they repented at the preaching of Jonah. And behold, something greater than Jonah is here. What is Jesus suggesting there? He's suggesting that the people of Nineveh knew the story of Jonah. So as Jonah's going round, he's not only delivering his short, pithy, pointed message 40 days from now, but he's illustrating his message. He's saying to these people, you may not believe in judgment. Well, let me tell you about judgment. God spoke to me. I disobeyed God. I went the opposite direction from the direction God told me to go. And did I get off with it? No. He hunted me down. He hunted me down to the very boat that I took. He hunted me down into the depths of the sea. He hunted me down into the belly of the fish. He hunted me down till I was spewed up in dry land. The judgment of God gets you in the end. And as they listened to his testimony, as they listened to his story, they believed God. They believed God. They came to this view, perhaps, if God could show mercy to Jonah, God can show mercy to Nineveh. And by good and necessary consequence, they hoped in mercy and believed God. And there's a sense in which this morning that's where all of us start. That's where we have to begin. That's where we're being led in all the influences in our lives. And every sermon we've heard, every word of scripture we've read, every Christian friend that has crossed our path, the influence of God's people in the world, all of this is to bring you to this place where you believe God. Not only for fear, but also for hope in his promises. Here was a people under judgment. Here was a people who came to believe. And here was a people who were pardoned freely by God. When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil way, God relented of the disaster that he said would happen to them, and he did not do it. Well, let me just tell you something. Some people have had a field day with that text. Let me explain what I mean. Some people have picked up on this idea that God is a God who changes his mind. There was about a decade ago, it still rumbles on in the background, a debate that was called the openness of God debate. Dr. Reichen wrote some stuff on our website addressing that very effectively so. And in this openness of God debate, there were those who argued that God doesn't know the future, that God doesn't have a script, that God is a reactive God. He reacts to things that are happening in the world. He goes with the flow. He rolls with the punches. He doesn't know what's going to happen tomorrow to you. He doesn't know how you're going to respond to him today. He's learning as he goes. Well, there's another group. It's called the theistic mutualism group. The key word is the mutual thing. These people believe very strongly that God does not change in himself, but that he does change in his emotions, in his feelings, and that he's learning from his interaction. That's the mutual aspect. He's learning from his interactions with people, and he's accumulating new attributes as he interacts with us in our everyday lives. Theistic mutualism. But what does the Bible teach? And what has the church always believed, actually? The Bible teaches, and the church has believed, that God is unchanged and unchanging in his being, who he is, in his essence, and in his activity, especially towards his creatures. So, for example, when God says, I am, that's an absolute statement, I am. Not I am becoming, not I will be or have been, but that he simply exists. He exists. He is in act. He is in existence. He is the I am. What we mean by that is that God is not contingent. Our existence is not absolute. Our existence is contingent. Your mom and your dad had to meet. You have to have breath to breathe. Oxygen to breathe. You know, you'll survive if you're on planet Earth. You will not survive on Venus or Mars without a lot of help. All of our existence, in fact, even the universe existing at this moment is dependent on this moment's thought and word of God. But God is not contingent on anything. There is nothing God needs. Because God is Trinity. That's the New Testament explanation. He's not the God of Islam. He is Trinity. And he is perfectly happy and blessed in himself. Let me spell it out for you for a moment. The eternal life of the Trinity is perfect life. If you ever thought that God made things because he got bored, you're wrong. God was never bored, nor was he lonely. He didn't make us because he wanted company. In what Fred Sanders calls the happy land of the Trinity, things are never dull and God is never lonely. The eternal life of the Trinity is perfect life. The eternal life of the Trinity is perfect love. The tripersonal God does not need someone to love. He is complete in and of himself. When we talk about the love of God, it's not like romantic love. Romantic love is often is prompted, isn't it, by something in the beloved. If you're really superficial, it's prompted by how they look. If you're marginally less superficial, it's how they look and how bright they are. Or if you're marginally not that superficial, it might be a number of other qualities that you see in them. But romantic love is prompted by what we see in somebody else. And you've really got to real love, I think, when you love someone for who they are, in the fullness of what they are, in such a way that you love them and there is no possibility that any variation in them will ever change your love for them. That is not love that alters when it alteration finds. God's love is not like that. From all eternity, God has had a Son to love in the Holy Spirit. Perfect love. Perfect glory. The eternal glory of the Trinity is perfect glory. God did not need to create creatures to whom he could show himself off. The glory of the Father was always enjoyed by the Son, and the glory of the Son was always enjoyed by the Father. You can't get more enjoyment than God's enjoyment. That glory is eternal. So what does God have to say for himself? Here's what he says. I am the Lord, I change not. Here's what the psalmist says of him. Psalm 102, everything else will perish, but you remain. You are the same. Or in James 1, God is the Father of lights with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. He doesn't change. That means all that he is doesn't change. Holy, good, knowledgeable, wise, powerful, changeless. One of the church fathers, Gregory of Nyssa, recognized that God was, quote, incapable of changing to worse or changing to better. If he changed for the better, then he was not God before. If he's able to change to the worse, then he can no longer be conceived of as God. You see this kind of thing right throughout Scripture. The book of Job, for example. Is it any pleasure to the Almighty if you are in the right? Is it gain to him if you make your way blameless? In other words, if you're in the right, if you're a good person, and your way is blameless and so on, does that actually give God pleasure? I mean, we say that, don't we? We use this, and we'll see in a moment why we use this kind of language, but in an absolute sense, does that give him anything? The Bible contradicts that. We don't give him something he doesn't already have in himself as an eternal quality. Here's how John Calvin put it. We give him no gain. We can do him no good. We can do him no harm, nor does he receive any commodity from us as though he had need of it. When God calls us to obey him or praise him or serve him, it's not for his sake, it's for our sake. As Calvin puts it, as for God, he always remains safe and sound. He doesn't lose anything or gain anything. He has everything. So in the book of Job, Job's complaint was this: surely the righteous by being righteous are owed a hearing from God. God sends his friends along, and they say to him, if you've sinned, what do you accomplish against God? If your transgressions are multiplied, what do you do to him? Do you actually do him any harm? Of course not. If you're righteous, what do you give to him? Do you add to his righteousness if you're righteous? And God himself comes into the question when he says, who has first given to me that I should repay him? Whatever is under the whole heaven is mine. You can't take from me and you can't give to me. God exists in and of himself. And I don't think it's put any clearer than it is by the Apostle Paul on Mars Hill in Athens when he says this: the God who made the world and everything in it, being the Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in temple made by hands, nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything. Let me spell it out to us. God did not make you because he needed you. God doesn't ask you to praise him because he needs praised. He made you because it pleased him to make you. It was his will to make you. He gets you to praise him so that you, in praising, may discover more of him and be blessed by it. But it doesn't add anything to him. In Malachi 3, I, the Lord, do not change. Therefore, O children of Jacob, you are not consumed. God is unchanging in his word. He keeps his word. But what do we do then with a passage like this that says when God saw what they did, God relented of the disaster? What do we do with that kind of language? Well, let me just mention in passing a passage in 1 Samuel 15 where the Lord says to Samuel about King Saul, I regret that I have made Saul king. And then later on, God says to Saul, listen, the glory of Israel, that's himself, the glory of Israel will not lie or have regret, for he is not a man that he should have regret. Now, those two juxtaposed passages of the Bible are telling you something. They're telling you that the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth, whose wisdom is unsearchable, who knows the end from the beginning, may appear to regret, may appear to change his mind. But he is saying to you that absolutely considered, he never changes his mind. He never repents. You see, the revelation that we have in the Bible is revelation that is brought down to the level of creatures. It's brought down to our level. Calvin says God's engaging in baby talk as he stoops over, as it were, to our point of view and describes things from our vantage point. He knows that we live beneath the sun. He knows that we think, I mean, most people until the last couple of hundred years have believed that the sun rose and the sun set, so he talks in the language. In fact, we still talk like that. I've heard Dawkins, the scientist, talk about sunrise. He knows perfectly well the sun doesn't rise. But that's human language. It's from our perspective. So God comes and he speaks at our level. The Bible talks about anthropomorphisms. That is, God uses forms to describe himself. Do you think for 1 minute God has a finger? Or a hand? Or an arm? Or has eyes? Or has ears? God has none of those things. He is spirit, and he is invisible, and he is immaterial. He is not made of the created stuff that we are made. Jesus illustrates this. When he commands evil spirits to come out of people with his word, he says, if I by the finger of God, no finger was involved. It was his word that did it. He's using it as a metaphor. He's bringing it down to our level and using it in that sense. And that's the same with anthropopathisms. That is human feelings. God is accommodating to our language. So when we find God appearing to change, we're seeing that from our perspective. And I think you can see this even from the text. You have to ask yourself, if God has changed, what has changed? Well, God's will has changed. Really? What was God's will? Well, Jonah's told to preach 40 days and you'll be nuked. Then if that was God's will, why has God sent Jonah? Why has God gone to all this plan, all this problem of calling Jonah, Jonah running, God chasing, Jonah getting on a ship, God chasing the ship, God throwing a storm, God getting the fish ordered, so the fish is there at the right moment to capture him, swallow him, protect him, submerge with him, and then throw him up. Why has God gone to all this bother and then come a second time to Jonah and said, go to that great city and call out to it? Why? Because the God who had determined to judge Nineveh had determined that he would save some people in Nineveh. The long-term judgment, by the way, was going to happen. Nineveh was obliterated. It's just, as far as I'm told by some of our mission partners who visited there and live near there, it's just sand today in the desert. It's all gone. God's word came true. The word through Nahum, the prophet, who tells about the end and destruction of Nineveh. But God had also planned that he would use the preaching of his prophet Jonah to call Nineveh to this repentance. Just like he said about the world we live in, this society, this city in which we live, that there's coming a day of judgment, but God has sent us into the world to do what? To call to people to come to Christ. We don't know when that day is going to come. So right now we call on men, we warn them of what is coming, and God is pleased to use us the way he used this prophet who was unprofitable in so many ways. God uses a slow, recalcitrant, selfish, unbelieving, narrow-minded, error-driven church, ridden church. He puts the treasure of the gospel into earthenware jars. Because he has many people here that he's going to call to himself. The reality is we don't know the full mind of God. And how it appears to us is because we are looking at God from our human perspective. Well, we have a great message to take to our Nineveh. By going there, Jonah is fulfilling the great task that God announced to Abraham, that in him all the nations, all the families of the earth would be blessed. John is inadvertently carrying out the messianic task. He's taking the message to another people group, the Assyrians. And he's seeing that the God who spared Israel can spare pagans. It's one of those hints in the Bible of God's bigger plan, that he was going to bring people of every nation and culture and language, bring them into the kingdom of God. So that comes down to us here today. What's God's message to you this morning? I think it's summarized by Isaiah the prophet. Turn to me, says the Lord. Turn to me and be saved, all you ends of the earth, for I am God and there is no other. Or in the words of Paul, if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. And how are you saved? The same way these people were spared. They believed God. And you will be saved if you hear beyond the words of a mere mortal speaking to you, the voice of God speaking to you, and you believe God, you will be spared. Not only spared, but given eternal life, joy unspeakable, and full of glory. Let's pray. Father, we pray that you would take your word. We rest on your unchanging nature. We wouldn't want a God who loved us one minute and didn't the next. A God that we could influence. We so much better to know that you who are against sin are against sin because you are holy. And if you love us because you are love. And if we give you glory, it's not to give you something, because you are glorious. And we bow before your majesty and adore you. And ask for your mercy. Mercy on this nation. Mercy on these people. We cry to you in Jesus' name. Amen. benediction. Now may grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest and remain with you, now and evermore. Amen. God be with you.